Hello, I'm Conrad Bain. Tonight on Different Strokes, we're starting a special two-part show on a very sensitive and important subject. Now, we urge families, children, and parents alike to watch both of these informative episodes and then to discuss the problem presented, which is of deep concern to all of us.
The man's name is Mr. Horse.
Right. Hey, Mr. Bicycle Man!
That show was very unsettling for me. I couldn't watch it. I didn't want to be around it. I asked him, don't write me in. Please write me out of most of this.
Give me a bite, please. Please. Don't just stand there. Help me grovel.
Well, Daddy, I guess he could keep his bike downstairs in the garage.
Yeah, Dad, and there's plenty of safe places to ride in the park. And as far as strange people go, I mean, they're everywhere. We've got one living in our apartment.
It was unsettling because I had myself gone through that. And watching it happen on the show, it was like reliving that all over again. I was reliving that whole thing all over again.
Maybe we better not let your dad know about the bike.
In fact,
maybe it would be best if you didn't even mention, you know, that you came back here and I gave you all this ice cream before dinner. Why don't we just make it our little secret, huh?
You know something, Mr. Horton? You're sneaky.
Sneaky?
Yeah, I'm getting a whole new respect for sneaky.
This is what happened in my life. And they didn't know about it.
You know something, Arnold? I really like you. I really like you. You and I are gonna have a lot of good times together.
We met when I was a baby. I was 14 and he was 17. There was a school dance at my school. It was called the Sweetheart Dance. And Fred called me and we were talking on the phone and all of a sudden he goes, Jan, I said, yeah. Will you go to the Sweetheart Dance with me? And he threw the phone down.
I hate rejection. Can't stand it.
So when he got back on the phone, I'm like, well, yeah, I'll go.
Dated all through high school, and I ended up going in the service, and I asked her to marry me before I went in the service. Mm-hmm. When I came home for good, she had a big oak tree in her front yard, her mom's front yard,
yeah.
And I come down the street, and there's a big yellow ribbon with a big bow on it tied around the tree, so.
I wanted him to see that I was waiting, and I will always wait for him. And I needed him to know that when he came down the street. I loved him, and couldn't wait to see him. Couldn't wait for him to be home. Freddie was born on Easter Sunday. Brought him home in a little bunny suit with ears, and then Mark came along 3 years later. We had a great time with our kids when they were growing up. They had sports. Freddie played soccer and baseball. Mark played soccer, baseball, and football. And we had a boat, and we went camping and fishing. And
we'd stay up and watch movies, and then you could get tired and they'd fall asleep. Well, I'd end up putting hair paint in their hair and putting makeup on them and all kinds of stuff while they were sleeping.
Yeah, they had fun.
And we had a blast. Mark had a great time as a kid through school.
Very well liked. Had a lot of friends.
Wake up in the morning, have 5, 7, 8 guys down there, you know, that decided to drop by and spend the night. So, raid the refrigerator.
He had one girlfriend all the way through high school. and that he loved very much. And he just was real popular and fun, and he loved high school. I don't know what prompted him to think about modeling, but
when he was really young.
He was in his early teens when he first started talking about that.
Yeah.
He wanted me to take him to a modeling agency here in Cincinnati. You know, we just have to tell him we just can't afford that. So he was not happy. I mean, he was disappointed, but he was okay. But I think it was a dream of his from the time he was that old, 12, 13, 14 years old. So when he got an opportunity, I couldn't say no.
Graduated high school and left for California.
My grandparents were the ones that made the move from Switzerland. They took out a map, and then they kind of like pointed like wherever they wanted to go. My grandmother made my grandpa actually do it, and he told me he kind of purposely moved to LA because he wanted to like see all the celebrities and stars and what people think they can see down here.
I think every little kid is, you know, dreams about being famous and being in movies and, you know, stuff like that. I mean, a lot of my heroes were actors. You know, Johnny Depp was, you know, the biggest at the time. I mean, and just everything that, you know, he was able to do, the different personas that he was able to take on, that fascinated me.
Everyone had always said this growing up, it's like, oh, Mike should be in modeling or Mike should be in acting. It was great. So I got a good manager and then I booked tons and tons and tons, especially print. I mean, it was like I couldn't stop booking it.
Yeah, he was thrilled. He was excited. We're from a Midwestern town, and that was really something new and something different, and Michael seemed to be thrilled with doing it.
I had a good life growing up. I started doing operas and stuff like that with my grandmother at the Houston Grand Opera. I remember going out at the very end of the opera and holding a sword up in the air. And like everybody, it was the very end, like going up and holding a sword, and everybody stood up and clapped and started throwing flowers and everything. It was just, and the sound of it was just amazing, the sound of the crowd. And that's probably the happiest acting memory that I have, the happiest experience that I have. I started developing an interest in acting and started taking acting classes in Houston and got an agent.
I don't know where you want to go. I don't know your venture. But this is California. This is where you make it. This is it. You know what I mean? This is where it all starts. You know, people try to die and they try to get you. You know what I mean? You're here, so wish you luck, man.
Thank you very much.
Wish you luck.
Just the love of movies and film, and I just kind of grew up with it ever since I was like 5 years old. I was in What's Eating Gilbert Grape. I was in a couple of other films, and I was in The Apostle with Robert Duvall and Farrah Fawcett.
It tells me of a Savior's love who died to save.
The audition process was, we met up with Robert Duvall, and he sat at a piano. My little sister and I sang some songs with him.
I have always been singing since I was three.
I remember him taking afternoon naps, and he would wake up from his nap and he would sing.
We thought he had a very good voice, but then we heard it from friends and even from people. You know, we would go to a restaurant and Evan was singing and people would just come up and say, oh my God, how cute he is, and he has such a good voice, and he has a talent. You should do something with that talent, you know.
I wanted to perform. I wanted to be part of that in crowd. I wanted to be friends with stars, so I could tell everybody else that I have friends who are celebrities.
This lovely creature as she stands with her hair full of ribbons and green gloves on her head.
You're just attracted to, I guess, being the center of attention.
Yes, this lovely creature, yes I asked, would she walk with me a while through this night so vague?
I was the kid most likely to be a star. I was Mr. Entertainment. Long blonde hair.
Hi, can I borrow your towel?
Yeah, sure.
Thank you.
Probably play the bratty, you know, person your mother warned you about. Yeah, I looked very young, so if when I was 12, I could read for 8, 10, 9, you know, and that's what L.A. looks for, you know. Like now, I could probably play, you know, 25 or 30, I'm sure.
You made an awful lot of money for the movie companies, and I would hope that you've gotten a nice big chunk yourself. You're doing all right, huh?
Yeah, I'm doing okay.
What do you want to do when you grow up?
It's tough. It's not as easy and glamorous as everybody thinks it is.
My name's Mason Gibb, and I'm 6 and a half years old.
If you don't understand right away that you're going to get a million no's and maybe one yes, if you're lucky, maybe, you know what I mean, then you shouldn't be in this business.
As a child, especially, you're having a door slammed in your face every day, sometimes 6 times a day. You could go on a year's worth of auditions and not book a job. And that gets very frustrating because you're not seeing any benefit from what you're doing.
If you're watching this DVD or video, you're probably a parent looking for information related to launching a career in the entertainment industry for your infant, child, or teen.
There's a lot of managers now in the business. When I first came to town managing kids, I was the only one. No one else managed children. They never heard of it. They looked at me like I was crazy. Several of the established agents wouldn't even talk to me. I must be a terrible person if I was coming with all these kids. It took a while to establish that children need management just like everybody else.
I'm one of the founding members of the then Screen Actors Guild Young Performers Committee, now SAG-AFTRA, and I have been the chair of the committee in the past. Now I'm just a foot soldier. Children are mostly willing to listen. They're ready to absorb things. They haven't yet developed any preconceived ideas about who they are and how they're going to get somewhere. We try and advise them what directions to go in. And when you're doing that, you're managing the parent as well.
When parents enter the entertainment industry, they are typically entering the industry because their child has asked them to, because it's a dream of their child, or because someone has approached them and said that their child was somehow suited to the industry. They don't have any idea how the industry really works.
A lot of kids I knew had gotten emancipated because of they wanted to have the studio see them as an adult so they wouldn't have to pay for set teachers and have to have their parents on set, etc. Like, you're more likely to be hired that way.
The actor is responsible for their headshot and their resume. So my pet peeve is the actor that comes in and says, oh, my mom has that in the waiting room. Your mom should never have your headshot and resume unless she's picking them up from the print shop. Once you are 8, you are responsible for your own career.
The internet changed everything for us. We were quite surprised to find our own children's pictures were being sold on eBay. Just the regular headshots, not anything salacious, not even anything erotic. Our kids were not famous at all. They were working, but they were certainly not where anyone would care that their headshots were being sold on eBay. And yet it became clear that they were, and they were being sold for a lot of money. And you wonder, who wants my kid's picture for $300? Especially a printed picture that we'd send you for free. We started the process of investigating. We started to put together a matrix of the photographers and the sellers and who was doing what. We were very disturbed to find that they were really close to us. Really, really close.
My cousin Darian, he was working all the time. Like, he went to 50 auditions, like, in a span of 2 months or something. Seemed like he was actually, you know, moving up.
Well, the way it happened is because of his cousin. You know, he was already signed with a manager.
My parents and, you know, my sister approached and just said that, hey, you know, Darian's doing very well with Marty. You guys should check it out.
Martin Weiss, better known as Marty, was a manager in Hollywood for probably a good 15 years. He managed child actors, boys and girls, but primarily boys. Marty had close relationships with his clients. He had sleepovers regularly, screening parties with his clients regularly. He would take them out Halloween trick-or-treating, all his clients together, and he would dress up like a dinosaur or a shark or thing one or thing two from the Grinch. He was very aggressive as a manager, though, and he was honestly very good at it. His clients got auditions. They got work.
He said, all you have to do is sing a few songs and you'll make it big and you'll meet a producer, you'll get signed by a label, you can star on Disney Channel shows. You know, what kid wouldn't want that, right?
It happened pretty quick. I remember he was signed with Marty at age 11.
I didn't really think, quite honestly, at the time that much would come of it.
Okay, our next performer began his singing career less than 1 year ago and already caught the eye and ear of several major names in the industry.
I remember I did the Young Artist Awards.
Well, he was excited, you know, he got dressed up and was a bit nervous.
We did too.
Yeah, I think maybe we were more nervous than he was.
For us, it was extremely exciting, and we were really proud of Evan. And it also felt, at least I thought it felt right for Evan too. When he was up there singing, he was like a natural.
Marty called me one day. He was like, Evan, I have a surprise. You got a Burger King commercial.
Open season toys are now at Burger King. You can collect all 8 open season toys. There's one for kids' meal. And you can have a smart treat like milk. Have it your way. With open season at Burger King now.
It was exciting because I'd never did a commercial and I landed a commercial.
Great to see your kid on TV, you know, the first time. Hey, there's Evan.
Right. So we were very proud. Marty really, you know, he did a lot for Evan.
My parents dropped my brother and I off at my aunt's house, and then we met Marty, and then he picked my cousins and my brother and I up, and we went to play basketball at a park. And, you know, he was kind of cool. He was, you know, he would make jokes, and, you know, he was very, really immature, and we were all immature back then, and he'd crack sex jokes, and I thought nothing was wrong with it. My cousin and him, they seemed to be friends already, and they would, you know, there was no filter. They'd just say whatever they wanted.
As we got to know him, he was, you know, he's a nice guy. And over the years, you know, he became more or less part of the family. You know, Marty would be there every weekend. And for every holiday, for every Christmas, every birthday.
We were playing basketball, and he would make weird jokes like, oh, Evan, do you know what a blowjob is? And, you know, they made me feel like I didn't fit in because I didn't know some of these terms yet. I was 11.
We came to find out that, you know, Marty didn't have a family, was alone and whatever, and he just kind of got, I don't know if the right word's adopted, but he just became part of the family.
Later that night, he just, you know, he was like, why don't we just talk about music a little bit? I was in the passenger seat in the front. He just kept driving around, and we talked about kind of what I would sing, what artists I like, and Marty, all of a sudden, out of the blue, you know, he was like, did you ever see an old man's penis before? And I was like, whoa, that's kind of odd, and I didn't want to, you know, be disrespectful and just get out of the car, and, you know, what would I do? I was kind of in the middle of nowhere with this guy. I told him, no, I never saw an old man's penis before. And, You know, we got out and we were walking, we got to a park, and there was a tree, and he pushed me to the tree and was like, I'll show you what a blowjob is.
Welcome,
bud. That is cool.
All right.
Thanks, Marty.
My pleasure.
Nice.
I kept saying no, no, and he was pulling my pants down, and I didn't know what to do after that. Like, do I tell somebody? Because he was really cool. Everybody liked him, and I considered it like nothing really happened. I can just brush it off. It'll go away, no problem.
Around November of 2011, I became aware of this issue of child abuse in Hollywood. You have young children who are aspiring actors. Because of these aspirations, they end up being somewhat easy targets. Some cases have parents who set aside normal cautions and allow their children access to adults when parents might normally be alarmed.
Any actor is vulnerable in that position. Actors put themselves in the hands of coaches, agents, managers, publicists, and by and large trust them.
You know, being up sometimes really early to go to these auditions and stuff, that was when Michael Harrod approached me and said, you know, well, you can come and stay at my house with, you know, the other guys that are there. He had three other guys staying in the house with him that were his clients.
Many of the kids that I worked with couldn't have even been able to take advantage of being in the industry had they had to have their families move here with them.
From 10, 11, to 16, 17. But I still thought it was rather odd, you know, that someone would let their 10-year-old son move in with a, at the time, I think, mid-50s-year-old man.
I do see the possibility that things can be misinterpreted, and I try to be very aware of that. No matter how closely you're working with someone, and you do work closely with clients in these situations, there still has to be that professional line in there where you say, we're not stepping over this.
We worry about stranger danger. Don't let your child be alone with a stranger. And everyone really tends to think that a pedophile is kind of a rapist, but really that's not how they work. They employ a process called grooming that is a slow, meticulous way of convincing a child and their parents to trust them.
And there's the official photographer with a nice smile.
The perpetrator in these types of situations has the ideal layer. You know, this is their environment. They are creating or constructing a reality for themselves that accommodates their particular patterns of sexual arousal.
The predator is looking at this as a way to work their way into your life, to make a personal relationship with the children and to be there to bond with them.
Whoa. Guys, big hand for Arno, he did it. It's a man.
Typically, a predator is grooming many, many children at the same time, and they're at different levels of the grooming process. Because a predator knows, like any tiger in the jungle, they're not going to catch every rabbit. They just need to catch the weak ones.
We went back and began to try to do some sort of reporting to try to determine how widespread this problem is.
Marty was very well known in the community. He had friends who were buying and selling pictures on eBay. We started to realize that some of the sellers were convicted sex offenders. We knew that he was somehow involved with another convicted sex offender, Bob Villard, who was selling pictures on eBay. Bob Villard was a very prominent publicist in the 1980s in Hollywood.
I knew Bob Villard casually as someone who was in the industry, and he did do publicity sometimes for clients that I had.
He handled big names like Tobey Maguire and Leonardo DiCaprio. He was very well known as a publicist. Bob Villard was also a photographer.
So I meet Bob Villard as a publicist who can, is a good photographer, bring exposure and whatnot, I believe through Michael Hara.
He was one of our biggest eBay sellers. it became obvious to us that Bob Villard was selling candid photos that he had taken.
You're there for a weekend, and he feels just comfortable enough to try to touch you when you drank a few beers, or it's always good to get that few beers, and he tries to touch me.
We always knew his photo style because he typically had the kids shirtless, typically took an angle that was from the top down, so that the children are looking up at the camera as they would be looking up at the predator in an abuse situation. Bob Villard was a manager, he was a publicist, he was connected.
I can tell you that the number one problem in Hollywood was and is and always will be pedophilia. There was a circle of older men, and they all had either their own power or connections to great power that surrounded themselves around this group of kids.
And it's widespread?
Oh yeah. I was surrounded by them. They were everywhere like vultures.
For us, that really connected a lot of people. Connections between how the kids got hooked in, we started to see the patterns. One of Bob Villard's favorite subjects was Brock Pierce. He was a common snapshot boy being sold by Bob Villard's eBay seller. Brock in the pictures was young, appeared to be 13, 14. Brock Pierce, meanwhile, was connected to Mark Collins Rector and Chad Shackley. We saw that they owned a company together called Den, which again, on the surface, it seems kind of logical that a child actor would grow up and become, you know, use their money that they had made as a child, perhaps, and open an internet company. When we started to realize what this really was, it became a much bigger deal.
I was a New York City police detective, went to college and law school, became an investment banker, and then I backed into writing. I've broken very big stories over the years, been very fortunate to break big stories. In the late 90s, 1990s, the NASDAQ went from 10,000 to like 1,000, and a lot of people lost fortunes. And one of the ones was Digital Entertainment Network, that I just happened to go across my desk, and I read about it a little bit, and I thought it might be a good story.
In the 80s, it was MTV that captured the attention of young people all over the world. However, now that youngsters are turning to the internet, a company called Digital Entertainment Network thinks they've got a chance of becoming the next big thing. They've created television-like programming exclusively for the web.
What makes Den different than other internet companies that have come before it? It's a fusion of the marketing power of Madison Avenue with the technology of Silicon Valley and the entertainment of Hollywood.
They were aiming their programming primarily for young people. So it was a whole new concept.
The majority of young people today are not finding themselves reflected in television. We're creating content that specifically targets your needs, your wants, your desires.
We're creating a new form of entertainment to serve the global youth audience.
Can we get a little sponge for Mark? He's getting a little shiny. It's hot out here. I'm sorry, a little shiny under the eye.
Okay.
Makeup.
Mark Collins Rector, somehow on one of the early chat lines, which were little more than hookup places, he came across Chad Shackley.
You really should be on camera.
I am on camera.
Who at the time was a 15-year-old kid, and Collins Rector was much older than that. Mark Collins Rector moves to be close to Chad Shackley, and then they start, for lack of a better word, dating. Eventually, Chad moves in with Mark Collins Rector.
Chad and I had jointly developed Concentric Network Corporation, which was one of the very first internet service providers.
And then they brought in Brock Pierce. Now, how Brock Pierce eventually landed there is anybody's guess.
A friend of ours introduced us to Brock Pierce. And Brock, at the time, was producing his first independent feature. He'd been an actor for many years, and together, three of us completed what was eventually to become Den.
Everybody was just throwing money at them. David Geffen, I believe, put in $250,000. Brian Singer, he had $50,000. Michael Huffington put about $5 million into this. It must have been $150 million that was pumped into us. Now, 15 years ago, $150 million was still a pretty good piece of change.
I need somebody to ask me a question so I can give you an answer. Is that Jay? Come here, Jay. Drill me on camera.
He was flamboyant. I mean, everybody told me he was very theatrical, very dramatic. He had a very good way of getting his way. Think about this. He takes a 15-year-old kid from his parents to move in with him. That's Chad. Most of us would be afraid to, even if we did, whether it was male or female, you'd be terrified to even ask that question for fear that they're going to come and take you away in handcuffs.
Surely you have something out of all this bullshit you can cut 5 seconds out of to get from me, right?
Yes.
All right.
Yes.
They had a great idea. Their idea was to make their own films and put it on the internet. Well, lo and behold, that's what Netflix is doing now. Of course, it's 15 years later. The problem was the internet or computers did not have the capability for that. But meanwhile, they were paying people money and filming as though it were a major studio.
I was called to go out for an audition for the show, Royal Standard.
I am 14 years old, and I started acting when I was about 5 years old. I enjoyed a lot, so it's a fun thing.
So we went over to Den, and I had the audition there, and I met him, met Mark Collins' director, and I met some of the other people there. Everybody seemed impressed, and you know, this is the guy for the part, the kid for the part, and that had never happened before, just getting, you know, hired on the spot like that. I thought he was nice, thought he was a nice guy. I thought he was nice, you know.
How I feel about working on the Royal Standard set, it's great. The crew's wonderful. It's a lot of fun working on green screen. I get to learn some martial arts more than I already know, so. It's lots of fun. It's wonderful.
We're in the basement of my house. This was where Mark basically lived for a couple of years. But he spent most of his time down here. He was kind of like a hermit down here. This is where he hid out. I was looking for some paperwork. Mike had told me to look for some paperwork that Mark had. Mark had a copy and Mike had a copy. I came down here and I found these documents. I found Mark's deposition. Mark states, I met Michael Egan in 99 when I moved to Los Angeles.
He called us and told us that he was working for a company called Den. I know he was really happy about that. It was a big step for him. Mike was with him at the time.
I had already met Mark Collins' director, Chad Shacklin, Brock Pierce, at a graduation that we had for our private school. There were only a few people in my grade. Scott Shackley was Chad's little brother. So I was introduced to them. And then they gave me a job as an actor at Den in a TV show.
Was that good?
Was that good?
Okay.
What are your favorite hobbies?
My favorite hobbies?
Mm-hmm. One of the first shows they produced was Chad's World. It was about a young boy who comes to live with this older man. It was a real example of art imitating life. Their lives.
Welcome to your new world, Chad.
Jeez, you guys fixed it all up for me.
In fact, they even filmed Chad's World at their house, the M&C Mansion.
You got your own TV, phone, VCR, stereo, your own jacuzzi. You got the works.
Oh, yeah. I think I'll be able to hang here.
It was fulfilling a dream.
In or about September 1999, both Michael Egan and I were invited to a party.
We are at what used to be called the MNC estate. Mark Cohen's rector and Chad Shackley's house.
Well, we arrived there and Michael introduced me to Collins rector, Chad and Brock. Mark Collins rector just showed me the house, showed me the backyard, the guest houses, you know, went through all that.
There was no expense spared at the MNC estate, there really wasn't. The pool was ridiculous. There was a swim-up bar, like, in the pool. Like, I can remember often being served lunch, like, the butler or whatever, the chef would come out and, like, bring lunch to the swim-up bar at the pool. You know what I mean? It was literally like going to Disney World for the first time. It was like, this is amazing.
This place you got here could definitely work to our advantage. Bring some girls here. They're gonna love this place.
Sounds good to me.
Before I even went to the house, like, Scott was like, you know, my house is different. You know, like, this, you know, the dynamic at my house is not like a normal house.
I guess I should tell you. They're gay.
That's cool with me. I have no problem.
So Mark was definitely like the leader, and then like Chad, it was like Mark, like the husband, Chad would be the female figure of the wife, and I don't know how in a normal context you would fit Brock into that picture, but.
Where do you want my eyes?
Right into the lens.
Into the lens? Okay.
If I was over late at night, you'd see like they'd have people over getting into a hot tub with Chad or Brock or Mark or all three of them at one time, getting in where he was naked and all of them were naked getting in the hot tub, and you'd start to see these different little things happen. I'd be like, what the hell is going on?
There's a skinny dipping rule after nighttime, so anybody who was over, you know what I mean, it didn't matter who it was, that, you know, you had to skinny dip after dusk or whatever. You know what's going on, so you don't want to look right at it. It's like the sun during an eclipse, you know what I mean? You want to look, but you don't want to look, you know what I mean? But, you know, I can't say that. I mean, obviously they weren't having sex in the hot tub, like right out in the open, but, you know, it was obvious to me that something was going on just by the position, you know? But I can remember just like, again, like, yeah, well, I mean, that's going on over there. It's kind of weird, but I'm in this Olympic-sized heated swimming pool right now doing laps. You know what I mean? Like, who cares? You know what I mean? And it was definitely awkward. Definitely.
What's the most exciting thing about Den to you?
The most exciting thing about Den is the people that work here, the people creating the content, the people that are running the show. We're a cool bunch.
Brock Pierce told me that they were going to a party in Hollywood Hills being held by David Newman.
This is American Bandstand. I was going to say if you're on ecstasy, but
yeah,
that's probably not a good idea.
I felt it coming there.
This is...
At this party, there were lots of drugs available, and there were many young teenage boys, ages 14, 15 there. Some of the big studio people were there, including Garth Ancier and Randall Kleiser. The party with so many teenage boys and no women, not even the caterers, had made me feel uncomfortable.
They would find the good-looking ones that they wanted in their shows and then prey upon them. I remember, I don't remember his name, but the one kid that was in Royal Standard, he was a younger kid, even younger than me at the time. And I remember once Mark had been at the auditions, they would go to the auditions and so forth to try to pick the ones that they wanted. And I remember the one younger kid, blonde-haired kid, I don't remember what his name was, but I remember Mark going right after him. Do I remember the first time? Yeah, I do. He had picked me up at the studios and took me back to his house. And on the drive on the way back, he was asking me if I liked guys or if I liked girls. I said I liked girls. And he goes, okay, well, you know how you pick up girls is you you put a sock in your pants to make your crotch look bigger. So when we got back to the house, he had gotten a sock and he would adjust it around and say, this is how it goes, like this, you know. At one point he said, you know what, why don't you just take off your clothes? Take off your clothes and let me see what you look like. So I don't know why I did it, but I did. And he looked at me and goes, oh yeah. That night, he dressed me up in somebody else's clothes
and wanted to take me out to dinner. And I wore a sock in my pants that night. He would take me to his, in his house, he had a movie theater in his house. We went into the movie theater. I don't remember how it was that he got me. He started doing what he was doing with me. I don't remember. My memories are of me, like, just sitting in there and, you know, being scared at first. We would sit in there and watch something, and then he would talk to me while he was doing it and say, you know, this is nothing to worry about, you know. Don't be scared, you know, it's completely normal. I remember being scared. And I remember him saying, come on, think about a girl that you really like. Think about a girl that you really like.
Royal Standard, you know, it's a good series right now. And hopefully, you know, when I get older, do a lot of film work, try to make my way up, and hopefully catch a good TV series sometime, or internet series, which I'm on. So.
We know that in child abuse, the power dynamic is tilted. You have an adult who's preying on the child, who is manipulating the child. They tell me in interviews that they're fearful of professional reprisals, and they're fearful of never working again.
He just showed me porn, and he told me, oh, these are clients having sex with their managers.
These 60-year-old men having sex with 14-year-old clients.
He just told me this is normal, like this goes on all the time. This is what you have to do. Everybody does this. Everybody who manages children. And he would tell me that constantly. Oh, no, you like it. And at some points, I believed him. He would say, we could call up this guy. He would be glad to meet you. And he showed me this whole business of people that would be mad at me if I told anybody.
It is this added element where these young children are hoping to achieve a professional goal, which creates extra weight on the child. Should he or she be abused, it would make it more difficult for them to come forward in that circumstance.
Mark, he would sit down and say, oh, well we're gonna help you. I mean, you're a part of our group now. And I mean, anyone that's not a part of our group is basically on the dark side, and you wanna be on our side. I mean, we control all of Hollywood. Basically, in essence, if you weren't with them, you didn't succeed, you had nothing. And he made that very clear in these sessions. Either you're a part of the group or you're a part of the dark side.
The sad part is, they can emotionally scar a child for life.
Man, I never would have guessed that Mr. Horton was, you know, gay.
Well, he's not, Willis. You know, that's the common fallacy about child molesters. They're not gay. They're only interested in little boys or little girls, not adults.
Look, I'm only 11 years old. Should I be hearing all of this?
I felt so much shame and guilt behind that secret that I held it for so long. Then I thought that all, you know, and then you start thinking that all homosexuals are pedophiles. You know, oh, guy's gay, oh, he's a pedophile. I have to watch out for him. He may try to get me or something.
People should get this clear. These people are predators. They go after young boys, and they do it for their own reasons. So this has got nothing to do with being gay. This has got to be because they're evil people. And they particularly pick on people who they know will be victims. They're predators. That's who they are.
In the beginning, it was all happy-go-lucky, and then things started changing. He slowly became different on the phone.
That's how it came across to me. Something's wrong. Something's not going right, because I can tell when he's not 100% Mark. Suddenly, he's not so happy. And suddenly, he wants to come home. I never knew what that was about.
Hi.
Hi, honey.
How are you?
All right.
shall we go in?
Your buddy's here.
Who's that?
Mr. Alvin.
Very excited.
So have you been to this house before?
Yeah, yeah.
Isn't this awesome?
Never been to a party here, though.
Have you been to a party? Yes.
Some good ones?
Several.
Like, how crazy do they get?
They would have big parties very often. That's what the neighbors were complaining about, that they'd have all these cars blocking the sidewalk.
They would have valet service all set up out here, and this street would be lined with vehicles.
Everyone was promoted to drink. I never had one drink ever before in my life until I was at that MNC estate. I don't ever recall ever drinking. I mean, 14 years old, it wasn't the top of my list.
There was an after party. Michael Egan, Brock Pierce, Chad Shackley, and Mark Collins Rector were present. Drugs were made available to us, including Quaaludes, Valium, Somas, Vicodin, Demerol, marijuana, ecstasy, and more. Brock Pierce and Mark Collins Rector tried to push me into taking these drugs. I refused. They then offered me cocktails, which I accepted. I believe that they laced my cocktail with ecstasy.
They would pull away the better-looking younger kids and keep them for their own after-party, and it would turn into a pool party. And then they'd have their rules. Oh, there's no swimsuits on in the pool.
That was the rule. If you were staying at the mansion overnight, you had to go into the hot tub naked during their parties.
Everybody's at a normal party. Nobody had swimsuits.
And the parties were not just for the young boys and for their amusement. It was also a way to entice investors. And they got a lot of investors who would jump into the hot tub with these boys.
Gary Goddard was around, Brian Singer was there. Here'd come Brian Singer, naked, getting in the hot tub, and then they'd make jokes of going and picking me up in the hot tub and setting me on Gary or Brian's lap. And then he'd have Brock bringing in drinks and saying, oh, let's just relax and let's talk about what we're gonna do. And I mean, Brock laughing that they had put pills in my drink or all kinds of different things. I remember waking up at certain times and not knowing where I was.
I was feeling very lightheaded, dizzy, and confused. Collins Rector then told me I could go to sleep in his bed, but that if I went into his bed, I would have to strip naked. Collins Rector then turned from being concerned and compassionate to forceful and threatening. I told him that I would not go to bed with him, to which he responded, well then, just don't worry about going into work tomorrow morning. I went to sit on the couch. At some point, I passed out. When I awoke, I found myself in Mark's bed and completely naked with my clothes on the floor. Collins Rector was in the bed, and he was naked as well, with his arm around me. I am not sure of all the things that were done to me. However, I know that Collins Rector drugged me and abused me. I immediately got out of bed, got dressed, went downstairs. I found Michael Egan sleeping on the couch and woke him, telling him I wanted to get out of this place.
I think the best way to describe this is a pedophile ring. That's what it was. Did all the investors know what was going on? Probably not. Did a lot of them suspect? Sure.
Hello, I'm Brian Singer, and you're watching Rollywood at www.den.net.
Brian Singer is a very prominent director in Hollywood. He's done some pretty major movies, The Usual Suspects, X-Men, X2, so there's been quite a lot of, you would recognize his work. What most people wouldn't recognize is some of the odd connections that seem to tie him to this world.
Know your star, Pickle Boy.
Brian Peck, who was convicted of child molestation, worked for him on X-Men and did the commentary for X-Men with Brian Singer.
Hi, my name is Brian Singer, and I'm the director of X-Men.
I'm the other Brian, Brian Peck. I'm not the director of X-Men.
I've asked Brian if he would help me out here because I'm a little uncomfortable doing these things by myself. Now, you're going to see something very exciting here. One is Stan Lee selling hot dogs. My buddy Gary Goddard was the guy walking alongside in the flannel shirt. And the guy eating hot dogs is you.
The fat guy in the Hawaiian shirt eating hot dogs. Hey, that's me. Thank you for, I'm on screen so long, thank you.
You are. It's in fact, you are so imposing in the screen, people don't even see Stan Lee. I think the thing that appealed to me most about it was the idea that it was about It was about anyone who feels disenfranchised, anyone who feels prejudice against them. I mean, it's really about a group of reluctant superheroes. Mm-hmm. Sort of their powers manifest at puberty, and they wake up one day and they're different from most of the people around them. And it's how they learn to embrace their extraordinary abilities and what's unique about them, and help defend a world that might at times condemn them.
A number of people I spoke to who put money in completely denied that anything untoward was going on there. And it was as though they were from the industrial home for the blind. I mean, if you see young men naked in a hot tub when you're having dinner, or you're having dinner with naked young boys, or young boys who are, you know, inappropriately dressed for dinner, and unless you're deaf, dumb, and blind, you say, hey, this doesn't taste right. Something's wrong here. These are not Pollyannas. These are very smart guys. Hollywood doesn't have any system in place to protect anybody, and children are way down on that list, I can assure you.
In a Screen Actors Guild meeting, we were all serving on the Young Performers Committee at the time, which is a national committee at the Screen Actors Guild. And another parent brought a news article from the LA Times that described Bob Villard's arrest and the fact that the LA Police Department was looking for additional victims for Villard. And said, I request that SAG look into the idea of distributing this article or putting out an alert or something to their members, that it seems like something that's a safety-related thing that maybe we should let everyone know. And Michael Hara had a very odd reaction that day. He vehemently opposed SAG getting involved. Hara did not feel that SAG should be stepping forward, even in the wake of the LA Police Department asking for more victims. So the SAG did not step forward and send that news out that day.
Well, I don't know that we've hidden them. I would think you would want to not hide it, but you would want to protect the child whose identity is going to come out the more you play it out. A situation like this never helps anybody. And yes, the sooner we can get it under control, the better. But the less the child has to live with the stigma of it having happened, I think it's better for them, not only career-wise, but personally.
It's why people don't report, because they know that even if they are believed, they're afraid that something will happen to their kid's career. There are people who don't want this out. The studios work to make sure this isn't very public. Brian Peck moved to Nickelodeon and coached on almost all their shows, really. It was one of those shows where he befriended a pretty major child actor. That child was abused by Brian Peck. He came forward and filed criminal charges against Brian Peck. And Brian Peck almost immediately pled guilty. Clearly he didn't want an investigation to continue, or clearly the studio didn't want an investigation to continue. The victim has chosen to remain anonymous all along in order to continue to work. It's unheard of that a child would be able to step forward at the time of their abuse when they're still a minor and continue to work afterward. I can't think of a single example where that's happened. So a kid that wants to speak out and say what happened to them beyond their family would truly have to give up their career. It's very sad that that's the case, but it's a reality. That's the worst part of it all, is that he's still working on kids' shows and he's still here. And he's been convicted. It's not somebody that we have rumors about or that we've had complaints about. There's actual convictions, and he's still here. I feel confident in saying all of the convicted predators that I have been familiar with had many more victims than the one that was convicting. We're absolutely talking about the tip of an iceberg. I'm not sure that we'll ever see the whole iceberg, because I think there's so many factors pushing that iceberg down into the water.
I think that sexual abuse doesn't get more attention because it's an uncomfortable subject. We don't want to talk about it. It's ugly. It reveals things about our culture that we don't want to know. But by not discussing it, then we don't identify it as a big a problem as it is.
A lot of child molesters will, you know, they'll have this defense or this argument that it wasn't hurtful or wasn't harmful. The child enjoyed it. You know, many of them actually use that type of language. And, you know, in fact, it could be the case that it wasn't quite as traumatic as we assume it was at the time that it actually happened. Now, the problem with this is that so many kids grow up to interpret that experience of manipulation and exploitation and abuse by a trusted authority figure, and then this psychological time bomb occurs.
I ended up in a hospital for a little while. I start freaking out and thinking that people are, you know, out to get me. And I was very, you know, just suicidal. Like, I'd always fantasized about suicide quite a bit. I had a pellet gun that I would fantasize about using to kill myself. I remember sitting in my room and crying my eyes out and sitting in a corner with the pellet gun, you know, just saying, why did this happen to me?
Yeah, I guess you could say I kind of fell by the wayside and let LA suck me in. I had started doing drugs and got involved with a whole bunch of people I probably shouldn't have.
Whenever I'd have any pain or anything, I'd drink. I'd drink and drink and drink and drink and drink. Didn't know who to blame or what to blame, and I completely just hated everything about everyone.
I'm trying to leave that stuff that happened to me at 12 years old as far as behind as I can. We had to have more. We had to have more and more, because we didn't want to feel anymore. We wanted to be completely numb of everything we were feeling. And, you know, and cocaine was it, you know, and then shove it down further and further. Meanwhile, I'm just shoving it down, just shoving it down, just shoving it down. And then one day when it all comes back up, I'm a full-fledged addict.
I mean, I thought I was the unique case there, but apparently I'm not. I don't know if that makes me feel better or worse. So many people went through the same thing that I did.
He comes home, and he's just a completely different person.
He never talked about going back out again after that.
No.
He never talked about returning.
And he was just so introverted then.
Well, he didn't trust, where before he didn't have a problem trusting people. He started drinking more often, and he would hide that from us. After he was back home, he said, I gotta tell you something, Mom. And I said, what? What's going on? He said, you know Mike, right? I said, yeah. He said he was molested. I'm like, what? And he said, what would you do if that happened to me? If that, you know, what would you do as a mom? What would you do? His drinking had gotten so out of control that even he knew. I mean, he knew. He couldn't work. He couldn't. It was just affecting his whole life. So we had to give him an ultimatum. So we just sat him down on the back porch and just said, Mark, you got to get help or you have to leave. And he admitted, I know I'm an alcoholic. I know that I have to stop, but I can't. I don't know how. I called the hospital and spoke to a nurse there, asked her about detoxing him and what it would take and how we would do it. And she said, you know, by all means, do not let him stop drinking cold turkey. It can cause stroke, can cause seizures, can cause heart failure. Apparently Mark wanted to do it on his own, trying to go cold turkey. Because one day Fred woke me up and he said, something's wrong with Mark. So I jumped out of bed and came downstairs. Mark was on the floor and he was like, had a rag, and he said, was wiping something up off the floor, and he said, Dad, I swear to God, I'm not drinking. I swear I'm not drinking, but there's nothing on the floor. Fred helped him up, took him over and sat him down on the couch. He goes, buddy, are you all right? And he said,
yeah, he goes, I'm not drunk.
I'm
Dad.
Not. I swear to God, drunk. I'm not drunk. I haven't been drinking, Dad, I promise. I swear. We didn't know what was going on. We just didn't know.
Half of his body was on the couch and his head was leaning back in his corner and his legs were
like hanging off
the side. But
he looked up at Fred and said, I love you, Dad. And Fred goes, I love you too, bud. He said, just lay back for a minute. And when he laid back, his tongue, and he was just shaking like this and clenched like this. And I ran to the phone and called 911, and Fred was holding his arms down so that he wouldn't hurt himself. And I'm on the phone and I said, I think he's detoxing from alcohol. I think he's, you know, has withdrawal. I need an ambulance right away. Right away, he's seizuring right now. Ambulance came and Fred had him sitting up a little bit.
They took off. I came in the house, went upstairs, started getting dressed.
Went to the hospital and we walked in. They said, are you Mr. and Mrs. Ryan? And we said, yes. It's your son, Mark Ryan, yes. Well, the doctor wants to talk to you.
They walked us down this hall into this empty room and put us in this room and shut the door.
And then the doctor came in and he said, I have some bad news. Your son's heart stopped on the way to the hospital.
We went back a decade to try to find contemporaneous reports, and we found 12 separate prosecutions of people who had used this lure of Hollywood to prey on children, and they were across basically all facets of the industry. So you have this phenomenon of crimes potentially being underreported. Moreover, some of the victims that I spoke with felt stigmatized. They felt they were to blame for the crimes that had occurred and feel they can't speak out publicly.
We thought everything was happy, everything was great. And then all of a sudden, one day, Evan just said, look, you know, he wasn't practicing anymore. And I said, what? You got to be kidding, you know, after everything
like shock,
that you've gone through. And
I was like, I don't like music anymore. I don't want to do anything with the industry, nothing.
I figured he's going through his teenager and you know, puberty. And so I figured, you know, maybe that's what it is.
I was like, I'm not going to live a life like this. You know, I'm not going to be held down by this guy for the rest of my life. And I needed a way for people to believe me. I needed a way for my family to believe me.
Hi, Anita. How you doing?
Okay.
Happy birthday, Evan.
I'm getting massaged, and it feels great. And I don't care whether or not it looks bad.
Okay.
It's above the waist. It's not bad.
Yeah, I had to find an excuse to get him alone where I could talk to him. So I figured, why don't we go to McDonald's so we could talk in the car.
Take a kid's meal, chicken McNuggets, please, with barbecue sauce. Make a drink, Diet Coke, easy ice.
You getting a shake?
Yeah, right. Medium.
Medium chocolate shake.
And then no whipped cream.
No whipped cream, no cherry.
Because I was hoping that we'd be talking for a long time in the car once he parked somewhere.
When was the first time that we met? It was,
First time we met was that one time we went to the park. You guys were going to the park to play some basketball.
And then it would be kind of quieter in the car and I can get everything on tape.
Because I remember you asked me if I ever did anything with the guy before.
Long time ago.
I was afraid if my recorder would beep or if something would go wrong and if he found out that.
And then that's when you asked if I wanted to try it. Mm-hmm. And that's when you, oh wait, that's when they gave me my first blowjob, right?
You're not recording this, right?
No, I'm not.
Thank you. Give it this way out. That situation that happened at Penn State.
Mm-hmm. at 12. Mm-hmm. I was not interested. I was just so... I remember that night, you did pull out your penis in the car, and I was scared. Like, I didn't know what to do. I didn't... Because you asked me if I wanted to touch it. That was in the car. In the van.
I'm trying to remember that. That kind of sounds familiar.
I just remember being in the car and you were asking me questions.
That's just it. The questions were to determine whether or not it was something that you actually wanted to do or didn't want to do.
I wouldn't go further in the music career. Like, I thought everyone did it. You would tell me, like, everyone did it and that it's normal and natural. That's the normal thing to do if you're in the industry.
Well, let's put it this way. It was... You know, I'm sure I said that. I mean, you know, it is a natural function. The only difference between us and the rest of the animals in the animal kingdom is that we socialize it. Take a look at animals the way they do it. They don't care about anything. They don't care about age. They don't care about, you know, sex or sexuality or anything else. They just, you know, they feel like it, they go for it. And as human beings, we put rules, regulations, and restrictions on it. You know, if we were any other animal, it wouldn't matter.
I was just numb when he told me. I was like, how could this happen, you know? And how could I not have seen it? You know, that this was happening to Evan. And I don't know, it was just so painful, really painful. And of course, the first question for me was, you know, to Evan, did it happen once or how often did it happen? You're kind of hoping it's once and that's it. But then Evan told me that it happened many times and over several years. And that's when I thought I was gonna faint. It's just so hard.
He just seemed like a great guy. You know, I'm not a violent person, but I wanted to go beat the living daylights out of this guy.
I'm dreaming of a white Christmas with Jack and Dixie running free.
The first thing that happened to bring the demise of Den was a lawsuit filed in New Jersey against Mark Collins Rector, Chad Shackley, and Brock Pierce. It was a lawsuit filed by a young boy who had worked for Mark Collins Rector. This is the first allegation of sexual abuse that became public. At the time, Den was gearing up for a $75 million initial public offering, which was going to make them all very rich. And when that started to leak out more and more, two of the boys that have been victims, Mike E. and Alex B., went into the estate with a camera to collect evidence. One thing he took pictures of was the huge amount of prescription bottles that were in Mark Collins Rector's name. OxyContin was one of them, but there was Vicodin, Percocet, Xanax, and there was like a lot of bottles.
We went back into the MNC estate, him and I, one night, and went through and copied every single one of their file cabinets from all their passenger manifests for JetWest file, all their American Express files. I mean, every document that was in those files we copied, cabinet after cabinet. We sat there at the copy machine hours copying them, boxes full of stuff. It's an email from Brock to Chad, and it says, "What do you think?" And it is a picture of a young boy. This one says, "From Brock to Chad, another interesting one from Michigan." Chad's response on that one was, "That's a yummy one." And Brock writes to him, "Would you like me to contact either of them?" Chad writes, "Well, they both look cute, but what's their deal?" Question mark.
The investigation and the lawsuit started to leak out, and Mark Collins Rector started to panic.
He could start to see I was being more distant and I didn't want to be around him. And I remember one time him specifically grabbing me and pulled me actually up into his room, into his closet, and would open that gun safe and said to me, "Do you not understand the power I have? Do you not understand the power I have?" As that gun sitting right there at you.
He had a gun collection. Number boys told me he would point the gun at them just like that.
Collins Rector would make it very clear. If you spoke about anything that happened in the house or anything about them, that first off, they would destroy your career. Second off, they've had people eliminated, 14, 15 years old. I definitely didn't want to be eliminated.
They came home and explained what happened, and I started crying, and I said, "This didn't really happen to you, did it, Mike? Did it happen to you?" And my son got curled up on the floor in a corner and started rocking and saying, "Mommy, I was just a kid. I was just a kid." And they threatened me, and I was just a kid. And I knew immediately that I had to bring someone and get someone involved. The police, the FBI, whoever knew I needed to expose these criminals.
We brought all those videos, the audio tapes, and gave it to our attorney, and the video of which was given to the FBI as well. And I mean, it wasn't just in these files, the names of Mark Collins, Rector, Brock Pierce, Chad Shackley, in the files handed to the FBI. You had Brian Singer's name in manifest. You had all these people, not just the three that lived in that estate. They were brought well aware of all the other people that were involved as well. I mean, I had to actually write pages on yellow sheets of paper, pages of the whole story for the FBI. They wanted me to sit down and document it all.
They were worried about being arrested. There was an FBI investigation. They had heard that. Somebody told them they were questioned about it. And when they learned that, they were in the wind.
I was talking to Scott one day, and then, you know, I couldn't reach him for a couple of days, and then it was only a few days after that I was there, and there was nothing. There was, like, literally nothing. Nothing was gone. Even, I think, the fountain, if I remember correctly, there was a fountain in the front yard. Even the fountain was gone.
And they went to different places in Europe, hopefully to avoid being arrested. And somebody gave them up in Spain. Chad and Brock were released quickly, but Mark was in prison for a year and a half waiting to be extradited to the U.S. Eventually, he was sent back to the U.S. and pled guilty to 9 counts of child sexual abuse. Mark got out of jail relatively quickly, but was required to register as a sex offender, and shortly after his release from prison, requested that he be allowed to travel to England for medical reasons. He did, and he never came back. In 2007, he applied for a civil union in the UK with an 18-year-old boy.
I know, I saw that with a boy. He was like getting into a car with a boy or something like that. And obviously, you could tell by looking at the boy that Mark was dressing him, you know what I mean? It was just like blatantly obvious to me.
And in 2011, he renounced his U.S. citizenship, and he's been untraceable ever since. Rest assured, the people who invested money did not want to sue them. They wanted this to go away. I'm sure small investors did, but Michael Huffington's, they weren't going to sue. The story was huge, and I submitted it. My editor loved it. It was quickly fact-checked, and then a couple days later, I get a call from his assistant to an assistant to an assistant who said, "We're not doing your story. We're going to pay you a 25% kill fee, and we'll give you about half your expenses." And that was the end of it. It's Hollywood. People do what they want in Hollywood. And if you're a big enough star or a big enough director, or you're making enough money for these people, you can do whatever you want.
Martin Weiss was charged with multiple counts of lewd acts upon a child. He was charged with 1 count of a forcible act upon a child under 14, 2 counts of continuous child sexual abuse, 3 counts of sodomy with a person under 16.
You see Marty walk into the courthouse, and he was in chains, he was in shackles, and he was a lot grayer.
now I had to go up on a stand and, you know, tell people, along with Marty staring at me, what went down.
He insisted that he wanted to go up there. It was a very, I mean, I was very proud of him, what he did.
I don't need this pain in my heart by being mad at someone my entire life, but it's more a matter of, you know, telling the truth for me and saying, okay, you know, what you did was horrible. I don't know. I just felt like I need to move beyond it and I don't need to feel that pain. And if he can accept it, that what he did was horrible and could move beyond it, you know, I could forgive.
The maximum sentence for the charges that were filed was approximately 14 to 16 years. Generally speaking, it's unusual to get the maximum sentence. He pled to 2 counts of lewd act with a child. He pled to 2 counts of sexual abuse. So it was clear it wasn't a one-time thing. And in exchange for pleading to 2 counts, which is much more severe, he was sentenced to 5 years of formal probation, 365 days in the county jail. He had to go to sexual abuse counseling. He had to stay away from Evan. He had to stay away from children. And he has to register as a sex offender for the rest of his life.
He was arrested in December or late November and then got out June, 6 months.
They almost never serve the full day-to-day sentence in county jail.
I mean, 6 months is a joke. It's a joke for what happened.
In any case, to ask a DA whether or not they think that they were completely successful in protecting the community from any future crime is impossible for us to answer. I can't truthfully say, or honestly say, that I stopped any future crime. I wish I could. I wish I could in every case. But I could only do what the law allows for us to do.
Unfortunately, to get bad people off the street, yeah, we need a better. It could have been a lot better. He could have served much longer. In that way, the system did let me down. And they're letting other people down. He told me that there are other people that he was doing it with. But like I said, I think it's more important to be able to speak about it and just be free of that secret than it is to really get justice in the court system.
There's a moment in the book where you, to a degree, introduce Corey to one of his abusers. Do you take responsibility for
that
emotionally?
Yes, I sure do. Yeah, and you know what? He asked me to take responsibility for that on the show, and I did. This is going to be a painful process. The dust is coming out. The cobwebs are being cleared, and people are going to know that we all play a part in this story, and it's what part are you going to take responsibility for?
I just think in many cases, it's a situation where somebody isn't thinking. The parent has become trusting where they shouldn't become trusting. Regardless of how good the situation looks, your job is to protect your child. But I still think it behooves the agent, the manager, the publicist, whoever it is, to know where that line is and not cross it.
Yes.
Hello, Michael.
Yes.
Hi, this is Joey Coleman. Yeah, how are you?
About you.
What, you were what?
I was just thinking about you.
Oh, you were?
Yeah, I was. I was reading an old Hawaii magazine, and I was thinking about you.
Yeah, well, it's been a while, huh?
Yeah, it has. I haven't talked to you in a while. Yeah. I kind of lost track of you.
Yeah. What about, have you heard from Bob lately?
Bob.
Bob Villard?
Oh, Bob Villard. Last I heard, he was in prison.
Oh, is that right? For what?
Well, I assume some sort of a problem with children. tried several times to get him, and somehow or other they didn't. But last I heard, he was, so. Now, I don't know anything about that. I don't know how long it was or anything else. So, no, I haven't heard from him in a long, long time.
Oh.
Kind of forgotten about him, actually.
Well, that's kind of the reason why I got out of the business. I don't know if you ever remember that I slit his lip open with throwing something at him, and I was on my way home never to come back. And I've gone through a lot of therapy, and I don't condone it, anything that he tried to do, and I got, Lord knows what he's done to anybody else, I don't know. And
I don't know, Joey, and you know, I take these things with a grain of salt. I'm not sure how horrible they really are.
I know
I'll never know the whole story about anything.
And where I've had the opportunity to talk to someone about it, I've said, look, this is not a terrible thing unless you think it is. It's just something that happens to you in your life.
Well, I don't think it's right for anybody to take advantage of anybody, and I think that it's that whole thing is rotten, what I had to do to me, and I... Quite frankly, I didn't like what, you know, when you tried to have me sleep in your bed and touch me and everything. I hated that,
yeah,
too.
And that was something unwanted. I shouldn't have done it. And there's no way you can undo that, but it certainly is something I shouldn't have done.
I don't know what Joey is remembering, but I don't remember anything that would have caused him to feel that way. All I can say is that as a result of the situation he was in, not only with me but with others, that was how he perceived something. It certainly wasn't anything I intended, and that was going to be my response to it.
I mean, are you attracted to young boys? Is that part of it?
Not particularly, no.
No.
So much of what goes on in these situations happen almost by accident. You get the idea that someone out there was a child predator and they were preying on children, and everything they did was to steer the child into this. And a lot of the ones that I at least was aware of, they just sort of fell into it.
Did anyone ever try anything on you when you were a kid actor?
Well, I guess so. My whole approach to the whole thing was not sexual. I mean, it was, yeah, I suppose somebody did. If I would be hard-pressed to remember anything specific, but it wasn't uncommon, let's put it that way. It's difficult when you're living in a situation where there isn't the adult supervision that there should be, to see how things are going to be perceived. And I don't know what else to say about it.
I don't know if Michael Hara is a danger to kids. I don't. We're in Hollywood, it's accepting, okay, whatever. He's a good manager. I'm sure he knew everything about the whole bomb alarm. To hear how good he is at playing the Hollywood coldness.
Great to hear from you. I was just thinking about Hawaii. Hey, you know, Sue, you're calling from Zimbabwe. Hey, I was just thinking about you. Really? Yeah, I saw a magazine on Zimbabwe, and I was thinking about you. You think he really saw that? His insincerity, you know, glib, lying through his teeth, you know, because whatever, because you from Hollywood people, scumbags, don't even get me started.
Finally let us go back and see him in the emergency room. And the doctor said that he's non-responsive to anything.
They worked on him for about 8 to 10 minutes, trying start is hard and keep it going without oxygen for that length of time is probably worst case scenario.
And a doctor said if he doesn't respond within 72 hours, he's probably not going to.
Well, me and my wife are, you know, we just take it one day at a time. We've had so much happen since we were kids, and then getting married and having kids, that we just take life one day at a time.
And I would sit on one side of the bed, Jan would sit on the other side, and we'd both hold his hand, and it was like just holding a piece of meat. The second day, one doctor had given up on him.
Yeah, you need to make a decision.
And he kept pushing the 72-hour thing, and I was like, your 72 hours don't mean a damn thing to me. And at 68 and 3/4 hours, Mark's eyes finally responded to the light. So.
Yeah, and then he opened his eyes.
And he opened.
Yeah.
But then there was no way in hell that anybody was taking him off the machines.
Hey, buddy. How's it going? How you doing? Yeah, give me some of that. Put your other arm, huh?
Fred is my hero because he never gives up. And he's instilled that in Mark. And Mark will never give up. He's the most courageous person I've ever known in my life.
It's good to see you. It's good to see you.
It's good to see you too.
Are you hungry?
I love you.
I love you too. You want to give me another hug?
He's a miracle already, just even being alive. I mean, they said at the very beginning to his family, he's not going to make it, he's not going to make it. Everybody wrote him off. He was never going to move, never going to be able to eat. I mean, all of it. And look at him now.
I want to comb my hair.
You want to?
Bangles colors.
I made that.
Is that cool?
For Bangles.
November 26th will be 3 years since this incident happened to Mark. And every single day, they've never missed a day on seeing their son. They're working to afford reflexology, aquatic therapy, all the different things that can help Mark and try to get him back. They believe their son will come back to somewhat of a normal stage in life. But this, you coached him, right?
Yeah, it's Ryan Foster.
You coached him?
He's graduating this year from Charleston.
Look, it says, thanks, Coach Mark. Hey, are you coaching next year?
I'd like to see Mark back on this field, coaching the kids, doing what he does best. He's a great coach. You know, I know that Mark is his own man, and he's made some bad choices, he's made some good choices, but I know that as a human being, that Mark is a good person. When Mark gets out, and he's back on his football field, and he's standing there with me coaching, God can take me then, but not until then. So that's what I want.
After the whole thing with Mark Collins Rector happened, it's made my life very dark. I was never able to have a girlfriend or anything. And I'm just now still recovering from all of that stuff. Like, I feel like I'm kind of at a point in my life where I'm getting better slowly. I moved to Florida about a year ago, and I moved out there because of my grandmother. Kind of wanted to be there to take care of her, and then I met a girl over there. She's my first girlfriend that I've ever had. So now, you know, my life is my grandmother and my girlfriend. And
I give them education, I hit them knowledge, not the difference.
Just trying to get myself back on track and, you know, trying to enjoy life and...
Watch this emotion, boom.
Boom, here we go with the emotion. I'm coming back coasting. Everyone knows I'm roasting.
Boom.
Not you, but Russ. Boom.
I'm just trying to tell you. I like it. I like it. I finally found a place that I like, you know.
Hey, the dream is so important. You know why? Because if you're living on this earth, you have to feel something, and the dream make you feel things. And that's what the power of a dream is, you know? Dream is life.
It's a hard process to go through the whole court thing, the whole police stuff, but in the long run, it's so worth it. Because in the long run, it isn't really about how long this person will serve time in prison or getting justice and revenge and all that. It's more kind of being able to express yourself and say, look, this happened to me. And I'm going to move on from it, and I'm not going to hide this in my head the rest of my life. And I'm going to maybe possibly one day make a difference to somebody else by speaking out about it.
I'm saying that there are people that were the people that did this to both me and Corey that are still working, they're still out there, and they're some of the richest, most powerful people in this business.
And they are.
And they do not want me saying what I'm saying right now.
What would you say to a parent who just has the best of intentions who's coming here with their child?
Don't go into it thinking that it's all roses and sunglasses.
You're damaging an entire industry.
I'm sorry, I'm not trying to. I want to clear up. You said
that. Ultimately, I think that viewers are the only group with power in this situation, because I think that there will always be a steady stream of kids who want to be famous, of parents who push their children in this industry. It's interesting how we will go and pay money and we will support a system which sexualizes children or puts them in situations in films where they're around adults who are engaging in inappropriate things. We would never do that for our own children.
Finally, after many years of struggling with this issue, Mike has felt strong enough to come forward and to tell his story and shine a light on this very, very dark, which, you know, I would say it's a secret, but from what I hear, it's the worst kept secret around. Because so many people have told me, yeah, this has been going on for years in Hollywood. This is nothing new.
So what do you hope to accomplish with this lesson?
I hope to help a lot of other people. No one at a young age ever deserves to go through the nightmare that I lived as a kid, because it's such a stigma to where you don't want to talk about it, or you're embarrassed, or are you going to be believed? At the end of the day, it's got to change. There's so many people out there that have been affected by this, and very few speak up.
If we don't speak out about it, then we are part of the problem, because we are contributing to a culture that normalizes this. And by normalizing something, it becomes invisible as a problem. So yes, we hold up these high-profile cases to say, these are bad guys, and we are good guys, and I actually think that we are all a little bad when we don't speak out.
There is so much damage that's already been done. And now I think at the end of the day, I mean, I look at some of it and I've really tried to kind of move on beyond all of it. I've still never seen any retribution towards those assholes. Never seen a damn thing. I mean, you look at them as they still sit on their pedestals, and the same thing's probably going on. Could have went on last night with someone, who knows?
Taking over the light now. All there is to be said has been said. Let the walls fall, let the shadows disappear. Let our story start from this moment here. This is a call to arms. This is a call to arms, you know. This is a call to arms. This is a call to arms, you know. Let